It's Jennifer from MS World coming at you from ECTRIMS 2017, and I am here with a man who needs no introduction, Dr. Daniel Kantor, around the world with MS World, and we are going to be talking about migraines. So I've heard that migraines can present symptomatically like MS, like they can see lesions on your brain. Is that true?
So you've asked the right person. What I do is I take care of people with multiple sclerosis. But I'm also one of about 500 people in the United States who is also board certified in headache medicine. And there's very few of us who do both MS and migraine. So MS affects, we used to say 400,000. New research from this meeting shows it's closer to 1 million in the United States. And who knows if it's even more than that. But migraine affects 40 million Americans. 3 to 5% of the U.S. population, in fact, has chronic daily headache. So if I describe to you a diagnosis where it's young more than old, women more than men, there's a genetic component, and in a quarter of some series there's white spots on the brain, you might guess that that is
MS.
It's not, it's migraine. So in migraine, a quarter of people in some series actually have white spots. Probably the most difficult white spot to tell whether it's MS or not is actually a migraine white spot. In fact, people with MS, not all their white spots are from MS. They have some from MS. If they're in their 50s or 60s, some of them are what we call small vessel ischemic disease, which, by the way, when you actually do a pathology, when you actually do an autopsy, there's not strokes there. It's just they don't actually know what that is they're seeing. Remember, MRIs are pictures. And it can show scarring, but it can also show damage. It can show activation. Somebody with migraine will never, however, have a gadolinium-enhancing lesion. That's why, although there's all this discussion about reducing the amount of gadolinium, because gadolinium can get deposited in the human brain. It's a heavy metal that can get deposited. We don't know if that's good or bad. It's probably not good, but it might not be bad. It might just be there. Somebody with migraine is never going to have an active lesion that shows gadolinium enhancement. So that's important. When we're making the diagnosis of MS, remember, even with a new criteria, it's still the same principles. Separation in time and space, and no other better explanation. So if somebody came to me and they just have an MRI, and it looks sort of like MS, and their only symptom is that they get a visual aura, and then they get a migraine on half their head, and in about 3 hours or 3 to 4 hours, it goes away, and it really responds to things like sumatriptan or other triptans, they have migraine and they have white spots on the brain. They don't have multiple sclerosis. You may continue to work that person up, make sure there's nothing else going on, test for rheumatoid arthritis, lupus, test all those tests, check for Lyme disease depending on where you are in the country. There may be other things you test for, but you don't just jump to the diagnosis of multiple sclerosis. Now, some people with MS have both MS and migraine. In fact, when I joined the University of Florida to direct their MS center in 2006, I looked at a series of 800 people. And these people, what I said was, of these people, who has a diagnosis of MS and then also has a diagnosis of migraine? But it was a coding study, meaning when doctors see you, they have to then write a number for the billing people. It's an important part of healthcare. Unfortunately, we used to use something called the International Classification of Diseases, number 9. Now we use ICD-10. It used to be 340 meant MS. Now it's G35. It's just numbers. But I also said how many of them also had migraine. And when I looked at the results, they surprised me. It was only 7%, which is less than 12% in the regular population. And that didn't make sense. So I looked at who saw the patients. When there were patients that I saw as an MS specialist, as opposed to a person who was a general neurologist as well as a nurse practitioner, my population was very similar to the standard 12%. It was about 10%. It was in that same range. In 200 patients that they saw, guess how many had migraine according to their coding? 2. That's not possible. It's statistically not possible. So what that means is either they weren't diagnosing migraine or they just weren't putting the code down. They were talking about it, but just they weren't marking it for billing purposes. I actually suspect that when you are a non-specialist in a field like MS, you are so nervous. Somebody with MS comes and they're complicated and you're scared. You're like, what did I learn in medical school? What did I learn in neurology school? And you don't ask them about other things like migraine and other symptoms that they may have. Remember, 4% of people with MS, their first symptom is going to actually be migraine. With that said, there has been a study called the Nurses' Health Study 2. And what they looked at is people who are nurses, and when they came in who had migraine and who later was diagnosed with MS. The wrong way to interpret that is that migraine leads to MS. It could be some people with MS that MS could contribute to migraine, although it's usually not the case. It's 40 million people with migraine, a million people with MS. There's going to be overlap of those two Venn diagrams, and that's just going to happen. It's the same population usually that's affected. But there can be people who have optic neuritis, so inflammation in the eye, and that hurts the same as a migraine, that can mimic a migraine. If you have an area in the brainstem called periaqueductal, around the aqueduct gray matter, that can cause a migraine-like feeling. I actually expect if you have close to the meninges, to the covering of the brain, kind of a hot topic nowadays in MS, but it's not the inside of the brain that causes pain. Migraine comes from the covering of the brain. If you've ever seen the movie Hannibal and all those movies, he's eating a human brain, and the reason the person doesn't feel it is there was no reason for us to have pain receptors inside our brain. Our pain receptors are on our skin, around our joints. They're on the covering of the brain. You want to know if your skull gets open and it's exposed to air. So there's a lot of pain receptors there. But once you get to the point of the brain itself, it's too late. So evolutionarily, we never developed pain receptors in the brain itself. Although the brain processes pain, the brain itself doesn't feel pain. So the migraines are coming from the covering of the brain. If you have an MS lesion very close to that area, if there's enough swelling, then perhaps that can also cause a migraine. And then there's some procedures we do sometimes that can cause headache. And then there's medications. One of my frustrations is that in clinical trials, you'll see headache listed as an adverse event. They never list migraine, cluster headache, you know, all those tension type headache. It's frustrating for me because I think we could learn more about migraine if we understood what medications might be involved. There are some medicines we use for MS as disease modifying therapies that I think can trigger a migraine in a person who's already predisposed, meaning you've already had migraines in the past or close family members have had migraines. So there's something about your biology that makes it. But if you look at some of the trials, when you look at a medicine called Gilenya or Fingolimod, it's about 25% of people had headache, whether they were on drug or whether they were on placebo or nothing. If you look at some of the newer S1P or sphingosine-1 phosphate medications, as well as if you look at newer studies of Fingolimod or Gilenya, it's going to be different. One of the new ones we heard today, it was 10%. Do I think biologically it's that different? No, because their placebo arm was 10% too. So it can't be. It has to be that it just depends on, at the time of the clinical trial, how good are the investigators about collecting every type of adverse event you have. I do also think there are a subset of people who have an autoimmune type of migraine. It is not most people. Most people with migraine, if you're watching this, you don't have MS, you're not going to get MS. MS has nothing to do with your migraine. If you have MS and you have migraine, it's important for your doctor to help tease out whether they're true and unrelated or whether they do contribute. There may be another factor that makes somebody more at risk for both MS and migraine. And that's a lot of the research that I'm interested in.
So you talked briefly about visual auras. So can you tell us a little bit more about that? What does that look like? How does that present? What is a patient experiencing when they're having a visual aura?
A lot of people, when they think about migraine, they think about very typical features, half the head. And actually the word migraine comes from hemicrane, like half the, and actually from French, half the head, migraine. And that's how they got the word migraine. But not everyone with migraine has just on one side. It can change sides, and also it can be the whole head. It should be throbbing, but it doesn't have to be throbbing or pounding. And then there's the issue of, is there going to be a warning before? And we call that an aura. And the most common by far is something called a visual aura. And those can be different. For some people, it's like fortifications. Some people, it looks like scintillations, like they see stars. If you've read Alice in Wonderland, a lot of what's being described by Lewis Carroll was probably migraine aura, as well as actually the beginnings of epilepsy. A lot of those kinds of descriptions, feeling bigger or feeling smaller, can actually happen during a migraine where suddenly you feel like you're larger than you are or feel smaller than you are. All the things that Alice went through, and it's been well documented, Lewis Carroll had some of these neurological conditions that impacted the writing of the books. So when you think about visual auras, though, it might be the classical migraine, but that's the minority of people. Most people have common migraine. And common migraine is when you have no warning. When you have a warning, it can help you because it can tell you what medicines to take early on. But there is some data that women who have that early warning and are on birth control are actually at a higher risk for stroke. And so those two things together. And so there may be more of a vessel or a blood vessel issue or vasculature issue in people who have that kind of warning or that aura that they have. But different people's aura can be very different. And some doctors actually drew it out. And that's actually how we know the speed of how the nerves spread, what we call the depolarization. It's called spreading depression. Somebody drew out his aura. And that was the exact same speed that later we found out physiologically. It's amazing what people did before we had all these fancy tools.
That is so interesting. So you talked about this, about the DMTs. So are there specific DMTs that patients should stay away from or discuss with their doctor specifically if they are experiencing migraines?
If you're experiencing migraines and you didn't have it before the DMT, then you should think maybe the DMT is involved. If you did and it's no different, then probably DMT is not involved. If you're not sure, if it's an interferon, so those are medicines like Avonex, Betaseron, Rebif, and Plegridy, those I believe can trigger migraine in people and they can cause flu-like symptoms and those can kind of mimic migraine. Perhaps with the sphingosine-1 phosphate modulators, and right now the only one is fingolimod or Gilenya, people who are already predisposed to migraine, I do personally believe it could put you at a higher risk. Doesn't mean somebody with migraine shouldn't take it, but if your migraines got worse and you look back and you say, you know what? Yeah, I started that medicine then. That is something for you to discuss with your doctor. It may be the right medicine for you, and you may want to be on a preventive, and you may want to think about other complementary alternative medications, magnesium, riboflavin, feverfew, butterbur. You may want to think about mindful meditation. It can help both migraine as well as multiple sclerosis, or you may not want to be on that medicine. But obviously, those are discussions you don't have with me on the, right here. Those are discussions that you have at home with your neurologist.
So that was so interesting. So is there anything else that you'd like to add about migraines? Anything that we haven't talked about?
So several years ago, we actually interviewed Dr. Steven Silberstein, my mentor, and also he's been the president of every organization in migraine, about the new migraine criteria and also about the new migraine documents about different treatment for both prophylaxis, so prevention, as well as for abortion of headaches. And remember, when I talk about MS, I talk about three things: disease modification, symptomatic management, and relapse or rescue treatment. When I talk about migraine, I talk about three things. I talk about preventing migraines, I talk about treating migraines, and then if you're in a really bad migraine, what can we do to get you out of it? And in 2 weeks, I'll be traveling to the American Headache Society annual educational meeting in Scottsdale, Arizona. And a big topic right now in migraine is one that I think people with MS can help. They can help because the big topic now are CGRP, or calcitonin gene-related peptide monoclonal antibodies. So suddenly a field like migraine that's never had these monoclonal antibodies that we've had now since 2014, they're suddenly having them. And I think they're a little bit too happy in thinking that there may be no side effects. Remember, we've learned over time with natalizumab, so tisabrin, with other medicines, there can be things that happen when you block one specific aspect of your biology. Granted, with us, it's our immune system, and calcitonin gene-related peptide has more to do with your pain, but there is some evidence that calcitonin gene-related peptide, if you block it too much, you may cause peripheral neuropathies. You may cause thinking issues, kind of mimicking Alzheimer's. So there are things that should definitely be looked at. And one of my goals is for us in the MS field to kind of cross-fertilize with the people in the headache world to make sure that we educate them so that they know what to expect. Doesn't mean we want it to happen, but I think we should be as safe as possible.
Well, thank you so much for speaking with me, Dr. Kantor. This has been a wonderful conference. Thank you so much for everything. Thank you.
Thank you and goodbye.
Bye.